Let's start with the first talk of the day, which is by me. I'm Simon Olsen. I'm a postdoc in France, and I will talk to you about the theory of market state models. So it will not be super mathematical, but there will be sort of bare minimums of the math necessary to understand the concepts that are important. And it's mainly to give you a sort of intuition about what you're doing, rather than to formally introduce all the concepts in a very concise manner. So there are several very good references for this, and I will put references in the lower left corner for you to take note of if there's a particular subject that is of interest to you, so you can look into it further. So without further ado, so maybe this is a redundant slide considering the introduction and motivation talk that Frank gave you yesterday, but nevertheless I will still mention our basic motivation for doing modeling is we're typically in a situation where we have a system of interest that we have some questions about, which is motivated by experiments or motivated by some general phenomena we know from biology or chemistry. And ways we can study this is by doing experiments or simulations where we get some information about the system, which is a realization or whatever. And from this, we estimate some models from which we want to make predictions of these properties of interest. So a typical example of this could be a protein, which we can simulate, where we get a time trace of some observables from which we can estimate a model, which we can do predictions of experimental observables, which we then have a mechanistic view of. So why does this signal appear? So these data points appear, it's because we have these two processes that somehow originate from this model. And the sort of the whole idea of doing this is sort of to understand what is going on in our questions in a more fundamental way. So let's take a look at BBTI. BBTI is this workhorse of molecular simulation and also in mass spectroscopy. And if we take a look at this 1 millisecond trajectory, which was conducted in the D short group, and we remove all the rotational and translational diffusion, then we see that most of the time, these alpha positions, which is indicated by these black spheres, they stay put, they don't really move around a lot, they just stay in more or less the same position and they wiggle a bit. And then once in a while, we have some areas where there's some flickering going on where the backbone configuration is jumping to some excited state or some higher energy state, stays there for a very short time and then jumps back. So this basic phenomenon is what we refer to as meter stability in a molecular system. And let's see if it's going to advance the slide. Yeah. And this is one of the things that allows us to create these very simple models from these very long and very large molecular dynamics data sets. So instead of looking at each of the frames of our 1 millisecond data set, we can summarize our molecular dynamics data into a very simple network model like this, which is still quantitatively predictive of thermodynamics, giving the relative percentages of different states, and also in terms of kinetics, predicting the exchange rates between these states. So in essence, this meter stability phenomenon allows us to significantly simplify the dynamics of, so give us a significantly simplified view of the dynamics of our system of interest. So a Markov state model is encoding meter stability in essence, and a bit of sort of a cartoon view of a Markov state model is the following. So it's a matrix or array of numbers, and you might have noticed that the rows along this matrix, they all sum to 1 or 100%, and basically what it means is that so the rows and columns are correspond to initial and final states. So basically, if we want to say simulate the system of interest for one time step, what we do is we randomly select an initial state, for instance the yellow state. We sample a random number according to this distribution, so it will most frequently stay in the yellow state, and sometimes it will jump to one of the other states. And we can repeat this exercise as many times as we want, and this will correspond to simulating the system, doing a realization of the system. So basically what this matrix is encoding is an object which contains the conditional transition probabilities of going from one state to another state after a certain time period. And this is sort of the central object in the Markov state modeling framework that we are working with. So what is meter stability in a more formal sense, without being overly formal, maybe? So if we imagine that we have a configurational space that we call omega, this is all the possible configurations of our molecular system, so all possible folded and unfolded configurations, and all the possible meter stable configurations, then we can divide it maybe into these four circles, where the gray circle is the full space, and all these colored circles, they are the different meter stable configurations. And meter stability basically means that we are staying sort of in the vicinity of this, in one of these colored circles for a long period of time relative to we staying outside those colored regions. So this is to give you some intuition, is that basically there are some global geometrical features maybe in this area that is characterizing something which is of high probability, and it's very likely to stay there for a long time, whereas transitioning, whereas being outside, so in the wide regions, is very unlikely, and it's only spending very short time in those regions. And so this is one of the central things that allows us to do these simple models, so this phenomenon. So it's not required to estimate a Markov state model, but it's something that simplifies things. And hopefully you will be convinced of this in a moment. Okay, so if we look at what molecular simulations actually give us, what kind of information they give us, they are a stochastic process on this space, so this circle that I showed you before, and it's Markovian with respect to this space. And that means that the transition probability of going from one point to another point in the space, x to y, is given by this, so very generally and very uninformatively by this expression, right? And it holds for any point, any set of points, x and y, in this space for any finite time, so even for zero time. So these transition probabilities are well defined in the molecular simulation. And we can also generate, so if going beyond single points, we can also go to regions or sets of regions by just integrating over these subspaces. Okay, so let's move on. Another property which is important in molecular simulations is ergodicity. And it basically means that there are no two regions in this space, in this circle, that are dynamically disconnected from each other. So we can always reach one point to another point in finite time. So, and it also implies that for an infinitely long simulation, we would have visited all the possible states of the configurational space infinitely many times. So this is, and another property that we frequently have in simulation is reversibility. So this is only applies in equilibrium conditions. But at equilibrium conditions, we have the following relation hold. So this is a mu we've introduced now is a stationary distribution. So this equilibrium distribution, which is given, for instance, by the Boltzmann distribution, where we have a Hamiltonian here. And this is just the Boltzmann distribution of this. And then times the transition probability of going from x to y after t. And this should be equal to the probability of being in y and going from y to x in the same time. And this is only fulfilled in equilibrium conditions. And it basically means that the probability of going from x to y and y to x is the same if you look at it from an equilibrium point of view. So we've been talking a lot about these transition probabilities, and maybe it's not completely clear what they actually mean. So what is a transition probability? Imagine starting in a single point in this omega space, this circle, and then saying, okay, let's try to start 100,000 simulations in this point, and then just draw random ending points, so y's. So we have our starting point, which is x, and our ending point, which is y. If we do this, then we get an ensemble of endpoints. So this is the scatter plot. So this is all the possible outcomes of sampling from this transition probability distribution. And this, in turn, shows us the transition probability density, so this object that we showed before. So this object here is equal to this density here. For there in a very simple, so this is a simplified view, of course, but and basically this is it's useful to think about it like this, because this will help us now when we are moving into the evolution of an ensemble instead of a single point. So we so far we've only been talking about how a single trajectory is evolving in time, and now we will move on to the full dynamics, which is treated on an ensemble level. So
let's see what happened here. I think there was a breakdown of Keynote.
Okay, so sorry about that. I don't know what happened, but we're back in action. So what we do, well, the assumptions that we do about the full dynamics. So this is the general dynamics. So this is sort of the starting point of where we make from which we simplify afterwards. Is that we have so the time series, so the whole time series, the probability of being in some state A after a certain time. Given the trajectory is just equal to the previous state. So this is the Markovianity property, that this it's a memoryless process, right? And so basically this means that the trajectory of all transitions factorizes into a bunch of conditional probabilities that we can just multiply together, right? And then another property that we have is this Chapman-Komarov property, which basically means that we can combine transition probabilities with different lag time by simply integrating over all possible paths between the two endpoints. And this is a general property. This may seem like, okay, this is a nice probably mathematical property, but this is particularly useful. We will see later that it might be useful, but just keep this in mind for now that we can do this. So combine, we can step, instead of propagating just tau one, we can also step forward time one plus time two by simply performing this integration.
Sorry.
Yes.
So this is strictly a condition for Markovianity. This property, the Chapman-Komarov property.
Yes.
So if this is fulfilled, then you always have a Markovian process.
I'm not sure if it only applies to Markovian processes. I think it's a more general relationship, but in the way that it's formulated here, I think you're right. Yes. Okay, so let's move on. So the further assumptions we do about the full dynamics is that we have irreducibility, so that basically means that we make sure that all the states are reachable in finite time. This ensures that we have a unique stationary distribution, so the thermodynamics are uniquely defined. Ergodicity, as we introduced before, and there are some, so this I will not repeat. And then reversibility, which basically is not strictly necessary, but basically means that we have energy conservation, no mass, so no energy production and so forth, if we have an equilibrium condition. So now we sort of introduce this object that is necessary to work with. To work with the dynamic or the dynamics of ensembles instead of single trajectories, and then we sort of go back to the same view as before. So instead of starting with this this single point and then propagating this in time many times, then we can start with a distribution of points in our space and propagate this in time. And for this, we use this propagator object, which is we call p tau, and this basically moves the whole density forward in space by a time. How. So this is the analogous object as just moving sampling from the distribution of a single realization. And mathematically, it's basically the following. So we have the density of being in state x at time t plus tau is equal to the propagator left multiplied on the distribution at time t of x. And this is then this application of the Chapman-Komarov property. And then we basically just apply this to propagate the density in time. Okay, so let's take a look at something practical and with a very simple model system. So this is the Prince potential. For anybody who's unfamiliar, it's a four-well energy potential with which is exciting to study for people doing methods development with Markov state models, because it has all the sort of the hallmarks of Markov state models, and it's very easy to work with because it's one-dimensional and it's easy to fast to simulate. So if we do a single realization of this potential according to some dynamical update rule, we can see that a trajectory as a function of time bounces back and forth between the local minima, and then sometimes it jumps across the big energetic barrier, and then it bounces back and forth between the other sort of smaller maxima, and then again across again. So this is just one of many possible trajectories of this length in this potential, but this is just to illustrate what we have to deal with in the simulation. So if we then look at the object, this propagator object, we don't really have a lot of intuition about what this actually looks like, what this means, right? It's just a matrix or some infinite dimensional object that we are multiplying on a probability distribution. So what does it look like in a case like something like this? So if we look at this matrix, or this object here, the square object, all the yellow area is zero, and all the black area is one. So basically, anybody who is familiar with linear algebra will identify that this is something which is the identity matrix. And then if you multiply an identity matrix on a density, then what you will get back is just the density itself. So this is the case where the lag time is zero. So you're not moving your density at all, right? You're just applying an operator that preserves the density that you already have. So what happens if we increase the lag time, so the time step at which we are propagating it? We can see that when we gradually increase this, you can see there are more and more off-diagonal elements appearing on this matrix. And we can see that there is some structure in this matrix that looks something that it sort of looks similar to what we see in these spaces. So there are these four blobs, and they correspond to this minima. So we can see here, reading off the axis on the x and y, we can see that there's some higher probability of moving around within the minima, and also to some extent jumping in between the smaller minima in this lag time. Okay, so this means that now we are actually changing the probability. So if we are away from equilibrium, we are changing the density, right? When we are applying this matrix. If we then move even further forward in time, so if we increase the lag time further, then we will see that now mixing between these, so within these states, is something that is happening within the time scale, because the off-diagonal elements are now more or less equal between these two things. So jumping between these two things is something that is happening in a single time step. And we can repeat this, of course, until the whole matrix or the whole propagator is simply just sampling from the distribution which is given by the whole potential. So when you just when you apply this matrix to any distribution, it will immediately converge to the stationary distribution, which is given by this light gray density. So why is this the case? Okay, I think there's a problem with the keynote. Why this happens is because if we decompose our transition matrix or our propagator do an eigenvalue decomposition, then we know that it, so then we can write down the eigenvectors, so the left eigenvectors and the eigenvalues, so there's this relationship is fulfilled, and at the same time we have the Chapman-Kolmogorov relation implies that we have an exponential dependence of our lag time, and this basically means that if we're increasing the lag time, so if we look at this plot here, we can see the eigenvalues of our propagator as a function of the lag time. And if we increase the lag time, we can see that the eigenvalues, they start to decay to zero. But since there's a relationship between the eigenvalues and the timescales of the processes that our system resolves, and when they go to zero, they will no longer be visible, so they will no longer be resolved in the model. So when we choose a lag time in our Markov state model or in our propagator, we will only resolve processes that are slower than the lag time that we choose. And it sort of also makes intuitive sense. And the reason why this one, the first eigenvalue will never converge because it has an infinite time scale. This is the, in mathematics it refers to as the invariant measure. So because it's not changing as a function of lag time. Okay. So because we have this, so basically this means that if you take a step back, that if we have meter stability in our system, then we can approximate this infinite dimensional object, the propagator, by some low rank approximation. So an approximation with a low number of eigenvectors and eigenvalue pairs. Which has non-zero eigenvalues, because a lot of the processes that are very fast at the time resolution that we can resolve, they will be already relaxed and we will not be able to say anything about them anyway. So we can approximate the full dynamics by some low number of eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. And usually we can guide this selection by looking at what we refer to as the eigenvalue spectrum, where there's a gap, and we can choose the lag time such that we get a truncation at this position. And as I've already pointed out, so everything that will be faster than this will not be resolved in the model. So what is this processes and this dynamics, what am I talking about? So if we look at these left eigenvectors, there's also a corresponding set of right eigenvectors that Fabian will talk a bit about later. Of the propagator, they basically give us information about the dynamics. So let's take a minute with this slide, because this, I think there's a lot of important points we can absorb from this. So basically, if we look at the first left eigenvector, this is the stationary distribution of our process. So this is all the thermodynamics of our system is encoded in the first eigenvector. Okay? If we look at the second, and then the corresponding eigenvalue of this is 1. Okay? And this has an infinite time scale, because this relationship is infinite for, this value is to infinite for an eigenvalue of 1. If we then look at the second process, this has negative values for A and B and positive values for C and D. And what this means is that effectively, when you are crossing, you are exchanging probability mass from A and B to C and D, and this corresponds to crossing the highest energetic barrier. Okay, so basically, the slowest process tells us that the process in our system that takes the longest time, or which is the least frequent process, is crossing over the highest energetic barrier, which makes intuitive sense to us, right? And if we then move on to the third, the third process, this is then crossing the second highest barrier. So it's zero for everywhere where there are no changes happening, and only non-zero, so either negative or positive, where there are changes happening. And the same thing holds for the final process, that is just the final energetic barrier, which is fast. So if we look at this again, you can see first the slowest process is crossing over here, right, between these general areas, and the second process is passing over here because this is the second highest barrier. And this one is the third largest barrier. So this is the sort of the three slowest processes which are non-stationary in our simple four-well potential. And the final thing that I want you to notice is that we see that the eigenvalues here, so this is one, this is slightly less than one, and then further, and this is smaller and smaller. So the corresponding time scales are also decaying. So this is first the slowest finite time scale, and this is the second slowest, and this is the fastest of the ones. And then there's a gap, so there's a big jump down. And then there's a bunch of eigenvalues that are sort of close to zero, and a bunch of them that are basically zero within numerical position, okay? And it's important to realize that we have this gap, this is an important property, because it basically means that we can, instead of having this very high dimensional object, we can just represent the dynamics of interest using these four eigenvector and eigenvalue pairs. Okay, clear? Yes?
What would the fifth one be? Just some movement within?
Yeah, it could be, for instance, move, like diffusion within the basins. And it would probably be the basin which is the broadest one of them. Because you have four of them, right? So depending on the width of them, so it will probably just be the diffusion rate inside the basins that they refer to. Okay, so let's talk a bit about estimation of the model. This is sort of more of a statistical nature. So what we do, so what you've already done probably at least 100 times yesterday is do the following, maybe without exactly realizing what you're doing, but basically when we have a simulation, what we want to do in order to estimate a Markov state model is assign each of our frames in our trajectory to a discrete state. So a state 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And what we do, how we do this in essence is basically that we first define an area which corresponds to a certain state, and then we give them a color or a number. So here I've just colored it for simplicity. Oh, Jan Henrik has done this, and I've copied it. So, and then we basically run through the trajectory, and then we assign each of the frames. So are we within the red area, are we within the orange area, green or blue area? And if we take, for instance, one trajectory, it could look something like this. We start in the red one, then we just jump to the orange one and the green one, and so on and so forth. Okay. So this we can then do for many trajectories, and then we can construct what we call a count matrix. And this is basically where we're just sliding along the trajectory, and then we're looking at the frames that are this far apart, are they the same, or are they corresponding to this state I or state J, so blue or green, or A or B, or 1 and 2, are they, is this pair, is this the case? Then we add a number 1, so this function evaluates to 1, if both of these statements are true, otherwise it evaluates to 0. So if the frame at time tau in the past is equal to I, and the current frame is equal to J, then we add 1 to the index of our matrix. Okay? So in the case here, so the ij's index would for instance be ii would be all the diagonals, right? And then ij, where I and j are different from each other, would be all the off diagonals where we have transitions. So self-transitions and cross-transitions.
It's missing a sum over t, right?
Yes, that is missing, that's true.
Yes.
So this is summed over the entire trajectory. This is why it's a count matrix. Okay, so let's quickly go over the maximum likelihood estimator, which you also used yesterday. And the first thing to realize, I will not spend a lot of time because there will be a lot more discussion about this tomorrow also. So we can express since when we have a trajectory of data, so then what we want to do is we want to write down the probability of observing this trajectory given a certain transition probability matrix, okay? And the way we do this is basically because it's Markovian, we can reduce it into a product of individual transition probabilities, which we can write as this. And we can expand this out for the entire trajectory. And then we can realize that there's only a finite number of transitions that can happen when we have a finite number of states, right? So when we discretize our space, we can only have transitions between I and J. But this is corresponds to what we see here, for instance. We only have, in this four-state system, we only have 16 possible transitions that can happen. So we can group all these transition probabilities together and simply count how often they occur, and then we can compress the the all this trajectory into this this product where we are now taking the product over all pairs of states instead. So we eliminate the time index. Yeah. And this again we can expand as we want. And so basically the exercise now is to find the P, so the matrix which has these P11 or PIJ elements that maximizes this functional, so this function of probabilities. And we want to do this such that it's a row stochastic matrix, so it fulfills one of the, so it's, so remember that the rows are summing to one, so we need to have this normalization condition. And if we do this, then the estimator is simply this, where we have the ijth element is the ijth element of our count matrix divided by the sum of the count matrix along the row, the jth row. So this is a very simple estimator, and this is also discussed in Jan Hendrik's paper. But there are a number of things we don't take into account here. For instance, there's the reversible, so typically in simulations we have a reversible dynamics, and we can also use this as an additional constraint on top of this stochasticity scheme. And then we can get a fixed point iteration algorithm that does estimation taking into account this constraint as well. This of course reduces the number of effective variables in our system, and which then can give us more robust statistical estimates. Furthermore, so this is used in PyAMMA as the default estimator when you're estimating Markov state models, but you can disable this if you are working in cases where you're not interested in using this, but this is a detail. Another thing, another way of not estimating models, but generating, conducting inferences about Markov state models based on finite data is using Bayesian inference. And basically, what we do is we say, okay, the maximum likelihood estimate just gives us one point which maximizes the probability. So it gives us the most likely transition probability matrix given a set of observed counts. But how sure can we be of this result? And one way of getting about this problem is using Bayesian inference. And basically what we do there is that we get estimates of the uncertainties of each of the transition probabilities. And to do this, we have to use the likelihood from before that we just justified, right? And then we have to introduce a prior, which is this probability of the probability of P. So this introduces all the information that we know that we want to constrain about our transition probability matrix. This is analogous to the constraints that we use in the maximum likelihood estimator. For instance, we want only positive probabilities. We want to have the rows to be to normalized. We want to have a fixed stationary distribution or want reversibility. And this is all the things that this is all things we can encode in this prior distribution. And then what we so when we multiply this prior with the likelihood function, we can show it's from the product rule of probability. We can show that this is proportional to the probability distribution over transition probability matrices given the count matrix. And this distribution is what we Bayesian inference refer to as the posterior. This is the likelihood from here, and this is the prior. Okay. And what we then do, instead of just maximizing this guy, we draw samples from the distribution. So we simulate the distribution, and then we compare what comes out of it with, for instance, a maximum likelihood estimate, or we look at the distribution of these things, or compute derived quantities from this distribution. So we do the inference by MCMC, and if we do this for a very simple two-state system, we can see that in the case of maximum likelihood, for this very noisy data, we get a point here, which is cyan. In the middle, so this is just one point, and if we do the Bayesian sampling, we can see we get sort of a broad distribution of states of possible models that is consistent with our model. Okay, so we get a sort of more nuanced view. Say, okay, even though that is this general area is correct, there's substantial uncertainty in our estimate. But this is also something you used yesterday to quantify the error bars in your time scales, and this is sort of the origin of this. So all the technical details about this, so the sampling schemes, and there's a lot of hard work that has gone into developing this, but it is the underlying concepts are really not more complicated than this. Okay, so let's look a bit at alternative estimators. This is something that I will not talk a lot about because there's a whole day dedicated, for instance, to these transition-based reweighting methods. So this is a way of integrating simulation data from equilibrium simulations with unbiased dynamics and then biased simulations, for instance, from enhanced sampling, and then getting an estimate of a Markov state model using information that is of high quality, for instance, from enhanced sampling methods, which give us very accurate thermodynamic information, and then the unbiased dynamics from the regular MD simulation. So if we combine these two things, we can get a more accurate model than either of the two things can give us separately. But more about this tomorrow. And then I will pitch a new estimator that we have developed recently, which is we refer to as augmented Markov model, where we which allows you to integrate experimental data into the estimation of Markov state models. So for instance, if you have a systematic error between your simulation data and your experimental data, you can overcome this partially by taking into account the experimental data and then estimating what would the Markov state model have looked like if we had had a better force field. And this is available now in PyEMMA 2.5. And there's a tutorial distributed with PyEMMA. So if you want to give it a try on Thursday, for instance, you can take a look at it. So let's take a look at what if we apply the sort of the regular estimator, so this the regular maximum likelihood estimator to our count matrix. So we have now talked a lot about different estimators, and we're just now looking at a simple case where we have chosen a single lag time of 1, we have constructed a count matrix, and then we have run it through the maximum likelihood estimator. And we get this estimate, and it looks immediately looks fine. It has elements that are non-zero and all the elements where we have non-zero counts. But if we then do the if we do the eigenvalue decomposition of this matrix, we can see that compared to the full dynamics, we have an order of magnitude of our timescales are under it. So the timescales are underestimated by approximately an order of magnitude. If we then try to do the exercise of increasing the lag time of our, when we count do the counts, then we can see that we can partially recover the original time scales, at least we arrive at the right order of magnitude. So this is generally known to be the case that when we are doing a simplification of our model, we cannot have the same time resolution as we have in our original simulation when we are truncating our dynamics or simplifying our dynamics by doing this discretization. So we have to go to longer lag times to have an accurate model. So this is one way of overcoming this problem, is by increasing the lag time. And so let's take a look at this a bit more in a bit more detail. So this is the right eigenvector. So this is the same as the eigenvectors that I showed you before, but normalized by the stationary distribution. So the stationary distribution simply becomes 1 for all states, and then you have different sort of step-like functions for the different transitions. So this is the transition across the major, and this is the two minor transitions happening in our forward potential. So if we have a good projection or a good discretization of our model, we can see that when we do this discretization, the error that we do when we are approximating these eigenfunctions is generally not so large. So we can see here, the dashed line is the approximation that we can do with this discretization, and is the full line is the solid line is the original dynamics. So even though we only have 4 different states, we can approximate all the eigenfunctions relatively well with this. And the approximation error we can overcome in terms of the time scales by increasing the time scale. So we can see that the relative error of prediction is decreasing for all the processes as a function of lag time, and also the time scales are approaching the true eigenvalues when we increase the lag time. So does this mean that we can generally just increase the lag time until we can just throw a random projection and then random discretization and just increase the lag time until we have a converged timescale. Not really, because in many cases, so if you have a very bad discretization where we do the segmentation in different areas where we are far away from these boundary regions, then in general we will have very big errors here, and then we risk running into some scenarios like this where the relative error is decaying very slowly and the time scales are converging very slowly as well as a function of lag time. And this basically means that we can run into the problem of the process that we're interested in our molecular simulations, that they will decay before we actually resolve them. So we have to increase the lag time. So when we cross into this gray area, we are below the lag time, and then we cannot really say anything about these processes anymore. So this is sort of one of the pitfalls of. One of the common pitfalls is this particular problem, we will work a bit on this, so understanding when this area arises in the practical exercises. Okay, so no problems of macroscopic models. So one thing is that we are only working in this observable space where we have defined a number of features typically. And we have done some dimensionality reduction of this, and then we have done a discretization. Dynamics is not always Markovian in this space, but we have some tools to sort of minimize this influence, this fact, and we have a number of tests we can do in order to make sure that we are doing a good job or not. And often, since we are only working this reduced space, we don't have access to the full detailed dynamics. So once we start to build a Markov state model, we are sort of losing some details of our molecular simulations. But this is sort of the basic fundamental assumption that we go into Markov state modeling with, that we want to have something which is simplifying and sort of catching the general idea of it. But this means that we lose something else, right? And since there's a lot of ambiguity in selection of these input parameters, it is often not trivial to choose which one is the best one. This is an active area of research, so the exact pipeline from data to Markov state model is not unique, and there's many possible paths to go. But there are some principles to help us guide which one is better than another one. So let's talk a bit about validation finally. Markov state models. So this you have already done yesterday, the Chapman-Komolov test, which tests the Markovianity of the data, you can say, or tests how consistent your data is with the Markov state model, so self-consistency. And basically what it does is it compares these two quantities, so it predicts the evolution of a density to a future time point, k time steps of length tau into the future, and it compares it to the corresponding value that you would estimate directly from your data. So when we do this, we usually assume an initial distribution, and then we look how this evolves in time as a function of lag time. And we do it for multiple different lag times, and then we compare it to the observed data. So in this case, we can see the observed data are these black diamonds. They sort of follow this very smooth line down here. If we have a short lag time MSN, for instance, then we can see that we are off, even outside the uncertainty. If we increase the lag time, we can see that we get systematically closer and closer. And the idea is, of course, to be within the uncertainty of our experimental data. Then we know that we have a self-consistent estimate. So the dynamics that we are predicting from our Markov state model is consistent with what we have had in our molecular simulation data. This is really what we want to have. So this is just a general outline of how we construct the Markov state models. This is something you've gone through already, but this, again, for repetition. We usually discretize some space that is suitable to resolve the dynamics of interest. And then we construct the transition matrix. We estimate the number of metastable states, and then we perform a Chapman-Komolov test. These are the sort of four pillars of what goes into Markov state modeling in general. So in order to understand whether we are doing a good job of describing the dynamics or not, so we, this is something you can go back and forth and change parts of each of these steps in order to get closer to having a successful Chapman-Kolmogorov test and a lot of other sort of validation criteria. Analysis. I'll just outline possible things that we can look at with Markov state models. So I guess I've also been motivated yesterday, but we can look at relaxation time scales. So these, we can get the time scales of dynamic processes. We can look at the processes and have a structural interpretation of what they are. So imagine these eigenfunctions can tell us about which free energy minima are exchanging on what time scales. And we can directly relate this to structural transitions. We can look at thermodynamic information in the stationary distribution, so compute expectation values, and so on. And we can look at the meter-stable set, so we can define these regions of structurally sort of similar models that are stable, so have a long lifetime. And Fabian will talk about this next. We can compute correlation functions, and from this we can compute a lot of spectroscopic observables, and then we can compute mean first passage times of transitioning from one area of the phase space to a different part of the phase space or configurational space, and then we can compute path probabilities. This is also something Fabian will talk about. And then, so some examples of spectroscopic observables, for instance, is the following. So, is a relationship to single molecule FRET data. You can directly relate structural transitions happening in this small peptide to a dynamic fingerprint that you can compute directly from your Markov state model of the same system. And here, in this case, for relaxation dispersion data from NMR, we can directly relate processes that are localized in the molecule to different contributions to observed relaxation dispersion data. And so there are more details in these two papers if it's of interest to you. And without this, so I'll just summarize briefly. What we have gone through is that the Markov state models, they give us a sort of reduced, simplified view of the full dynamics, which we assume is Markovian. And we can estimate this using data, which is reduced, which is projected on some space of interest. And we can, and in a sense, are usually useful when we can minimize these errors, discretization errors of our eigenfunctions. And when we can do this, when we can reduce this error to some arbitrary small number, then we can predict the original quantities with high accuracy. So.